So good morning everyone. Today we'll start with the new lecture series on GSM architecture, right? So in the previous class we dealt with what we dealt with is limitations of mobile devices and GSM services. So GSM services deals with how the database being transferred into the network, what are the tele services and what are the mobile services we have. And in today's class we'll deal with the GSM architecture. So before getting into the architecture, let us discuss why we are choosing. So in GSM network, what happens is entire India or entire country is divided into hexagonal shapes. Why this is divided into hexagonals? So right, so what happens? So assume that this is one area, okay, and this is some area, and this is some area, right? So what happens, we need to find out where we need to keep the towers, guys. From now onwards, whatever we are referring to a tower, it is called as a base transceiver station. Tower means whatever we see on the roadside, towers, it is called as a BTS. BTS means base transceiver stations. So in order to know where these towers should be placed, the entire area is divided into hexagonal shapes. Okay, why we are not considering either circle or triangle or some square? Why? Because if you calculate the area for one unit for each of these components, and with respect to this we are also calculating for hexagon, so what happens is area of triangle is less than area of square is less than area of triangle is less than area of square. So that means these two have a lesser area when compared to circle and hexagon. So we are not considering these things. Okay. So in between circle and hexagon, obviously circle will have the highest area. Okay. So why we are not considering circles? The main thing. So see here. If you draw the circles like this, what happens? Whatever the meanwhile area is there, it is not getting covered. Yes. So in order to avoid this concept, we are getting into the concept of hexagons. So if you see this in the picture, so every part of the area is covered with hexagon. That means so what happens if it is covered with hexagon, it means all the base transceiver stations will be able to send signals to every place in the country, right? Other than Himalayas and mountaineering areas, we are considering this concept. Okay, so that is the reason why we are considering the hexagonal shapes, right? And the next thing is, now we are going to GSM architecture. So this is the GSM architecture. So it is going to get contained with three parts. One is, just listen to this, I explained you with the example in the next slide. Okay. So it is going to contain three components. One is RSS, second one is NSS, and third one is OSS. So RSS stands for radio subsystem, where it deals with the radio interfacing components. So this is a symbol for radios. Remember that this is a symbol for radio wave communication. Okay. So to transfer the signal from mobile station to base transceiver station, it is going to use radio waves. That is why it is indicated like this. Okay, so guys, listen to this carefully and remember what I am saying. Mobile station means whatever smartphone we are using is called a mobile station technically. Base transceiver station means whatever we see on the roadside towers, white and red towers. Okay, that is called as a base transceiver station. Okay, and next one is BSE and MSE. We will not be able to see this. These are the service providers. These are maintained by the service providers itself. And only these two are the visible components. These are the internal components that are maintained by the service providers itself. Okay. Mobile station means smartphone. Base transceiver station means the towers we see on the roadside are called as a base transceiver stations. Okay. So it is going to deal with the radio interfaces. And the main part of GSM architecture is lies in this network subsystem. NSS stands for network subsystem. It is the heart of this GSM architecture. The main component in this is MSC. Right? And next one, OSS. OSS stands for operating subsystem. So it is going to maintain the accounting informations. That means whenever you speak onto your phone, what happens? You'll be getting a pop-up like this much amount of data is charged for your call, and this is the relevant data balance you have, and this is the internet balance you have, right? So it is going to show a pop-up like that, and it is going to sometime, if your recharge is going to expire, it is going to send some status messages, right? So these type of services are taken care by the operating system. Okay, then call setup. So how the call needs to be connected. Okay, and what happens when we move from one location to another location, that is taken care by the NSS. And RSS is used for communicating to mobile stations. Right? Understood? So these are the components. We'll discuss this in depth in the next slides. So see here, before getting into the architecture, let me explain this with the help of an example. So assume that you are in this is Andhra Pradesh and this is Karnataka, and this is some Kerala, right? So just for the assumption, I'm drawing this. So in AP, you have Guntur district and Prakasam. So you have the number of districts. In Guntur, you have number of areas like Brodipet, Old Guntur, Lakshmipuram, Vidyanagar. Okay, these are some of the areas in Guntur. Okay, so see here. So first, I am a new to Guntur, and I have recently shifted here from another state. Okay, so now my home location is Guntur. Okay, so why I am considering my home location as Guntur is, so I am going to take a SIM from the Guntur. Okay, that means, so wherever I am taking the SIM, that details will be present in HLR. HLR is a database that contains where I take the SIM, where I get registered. That is called as a HLR. Okay. So I have taken the SIM and got registered, and authentication, everything is done there. Okay. So for authentication, what happens? We'll get a phone call, and there we are going to tell the basic details of our Aadhaar number and everything. So if that matches the database, if that matches the caller, the where we are telling. So what happens is these details get authenticated and our SIM gets activated, right? So my SIM got activated right now. So what I need to do is I'm working in Vignan. So what I need to do, I need to go from Guntur to Tenali, right? So what happens, daily I'm moving from Guntur to Tenali. So from this HLR is a permanent database where I have taken the SIM. So my details should be registered in Tenali. Why my details should be registered? Because whenever in movies we will see that when they are speaking to phone, it will trace out the location, right? So where they are and everything based on the voice, based on the calls they are doing, right? So how it is being found out is by using the concept of VLR. So what is VLR? VLR is a visitor location register. So this visitor location register is a dynamic database. So from Guntur to Tenali, I have went there. So what happens? My details should be registered in VLR. Okay. So this VLR is going to assign some TMSI. Internally, what's happening is when I move to the new location, it is going to assign me with some temporary number. Based on that, it is going to identify my original number. So before adding this TMSI, that is temporary mobile subscriber identity. So before adding this TMSI, it is going to get the details from HLR. Okay, so it needs to get authenticated from here. If it is valid, it is going to add the details. If it is not valid, the signal will be stopped. So these are the two main responsibilities of HLR and VLR. So this is what happening internally. So what happens whenever we move from out of this state? When we move to out of this state, what happens is this is taken care by MSC. So MSC deals with how the roaming is taking place, how the connection call setup is taking place. So one MSC is taking care of AP. Another MSC is taking care of some Karnataka, right? So what happens here, if I am moving from Andhra Pradesh to Karnataka, the details of my data present in HLR, it's been taken by MSC from the HLR, and these details will be transferred to the MSC related to Karnataka, and these details will get stored in VLR. Why VLR? Because I'm a person new to this state. I'm a person who is not having SIM related to this state. I'm having a SIM related to the Andhra Pradesh. That is why my database, my details will be present in VLR. Okay, so this handover is taken care by MSC. Okay, understood? So internally, this is what happening. So whenever you are moving to one, initially whenever you take this SIM, that details will be present in HLR. Whenever you move to new place, by assigning a temporary mobile subscriber identity, by assigning a temporary number, your details will get stored in VLR by taking the details from HLR. Okay, so and next thing is, so whenever you move from one state to another state, the handover is taken care from one MSC to another MSC. Okay, so meanwhile, what happened whenever? So assume that another scenario, you are in Guntur itself and you are roaming in these four areas. Okay, so while you are roaming in these four areas, the cell is common, but the base transceiver stations might be different. So the handling of call from one base transceiver station to another base transceiver station is taken care by BSC. Guys, listen. In BSC, the responsibility of BSC is to transfer the pulse from in the same area, in the same district. For simplicity, I am telling you this. So in BSC, to transfer the pulse from one BTS to another BTS within the state, if you are roaming anywhere, that is taken care by BSC. If you move to the different state, that is taken care by MSC. Or if you move to the other country, that is also taken care by MSC. If you get subscribed with the SIM in the particular district, your details will be present in HLR. If you move to the new location, that details will be forwarded into VLR by authenticating from the HLR. Okay? So, and wherever you are, you need to get the pop-ups and alerts. What are the data balances you have? What is the internet balance? When your plan is going to expire? In order to find out all these things, we are going to use the component called operating subsystem. The main heart of this GSM architecture lies in network subsystem. Okay, so let us now discuss with the in an elaborated way. So these are the components that are present in RSS, radio subsystem. So MS means mobile station, that is a mobile phone you are using. BSS means base station subsystem. So what is BSS? This entire part is called as a BSS. It is a combination of MS plus BTS plus BSC is called a BSS. So BSS stands for base station subsystem. And next one is BTS. BTS means, so whatever the towers you see on the roadside, they are called as a BTS, base transceiver stations. And next one is base station controller. This is taken care by service provider. Either that can be, for example, that can be Airtel or Jio or BSNL or Vodafone or Uninor. So these are the service providers. They will be having different base station controllers. And next thing is NSS. NSS stands for network switching subsystem. So MSC means mobile switching center, HLR means home location register, VLR means visitor location register. And next, coming to operating subsystem. So these two are databases. So this is a permanent database. And VLR is a dynamic database. And next, coming to operating subsystem. So it is going to deal with the traffic monitoring, status reportings and defective devices. So it is going to maintain with three components. One is OMC, AUC and EAR. OMC stands for Operation and Maintenance Center. AUC stands for Authentication Center. EAR stands for Equipment Identity Register. So let us now discuss this one by one component in depth. So first, coming to radio subsystem. So radio subsystem means it contains four components, as we have seen in the figure. One is mobile station, base station controller, base transceiver station. And this entire unit is, so these two contains, this entire unit is called base station subsystem. Okay, so first dealing with mobile station. What I told you, mobile station means a mobile phone. So what does mobile phone contains? SIM. So with respect to SIM, if your phone gets blocked, what you need to have? You need to have a unblocking key. That is PUK. That means PUK stands for PIN Unblocking if you give password for 3 times wrong, what happens? Your phone gets blocked. So when you call to service provider, they will give you an unblocking key which is of some 4 digits. So that is the key used for unblocking the phone. That is called as a PU key. And next you have PIN. That means your security PIN, personal identification number, and authentication key for while you are speaking, your data will be transferred over the network. So in order to encrypt and decrypt this data, you will be having a authentication key, right? And with respect to this, your mobile will have a IMEI number. So when you lost your phone somewhere, so how it's been traced is by using this IMEI numbers. International Mobile Equipment Identity. Okay, so what happens whenever you are in particular area, your mobile is identified with the number that is provided with SIM. Okay, so whenever you move to some other area, your number is mobile identified with TMSI. So I already told you what is TMSI. Temporary Mobile Subscriber Identity. So whenever you are moving to other location from Guntur, to assume that your home location is Guntur and you are moving to Tenali, what happens? Your number is allotted with some temporary mobile number. So in order to have the concept of data abstraction, that means hiding the user details, you are going for the concept of TMSI. So how it is allotting is, initially it needs to gain the data from HLR. If the authentication is done, then only it is going to allot the TMSI. Okay, so this is the basic details of mobile station. So this mobile station is going to contain a 10 digit mobile number, 10 digit mobile number plus sign and 2 digit country code. That means if you want to give some number, it is written as +91, 10 digits. Okay, this is with respect to the mobile station. And next, coming to base transceiver station. So base transceiver station means whatever the towers you see, those are called as a base transceiver stations. So what does this base transceiver station contains at the top? It is going to contain a transceiver, nothing but a antenna. It is going to contain amplifiers. Amplifier, why we are using amplifiers? In order to strengthen the signal, we will be using amplifiers. Okay, so these are the components that are present in base transceiver stations. So how we need to determine where they should be placed? Each base transceiver station can transmit signal from 100 meters to 35 kilometers. So you can ask me one question, madam, if it is 35 kilometers, why we are seeing these many towers? So if the population is very less, it happened with one antenna. But if the population is very high, is it possible to manage all the signals with one BTS? No. So to eradicate that concept, we are placing the base transceiver stations from the distance apart. Okay, so how these are placed is by using the concept of cell sectorization. So previously we saw that the entire India is divided into hexagonal shape. So that hexagonals are called as cells. So in this cell, by using the cell sectorized concept, here we are going to place BTS which covers around 100 meters to 35 kilometers. If the population is very less, it is sufficient with one antenna. If the population is very high, we need to have number of antennas. That is the concept of BTS. And next one is base station controller. So assume that you are moving from Guntur to Tenali. Meanwhile, you will see 2-3 towers, right? So what? Why we are having that? Due to high population, we are placing number of towers. So whenever you are moving, if your signal is from Guntur, is it possible to talk to your friend? No, right? That means while you are moving, your signal also should get transmitted from one tower to another tower. So the transferring of this signal from one BTS to another BTS is taken care by base station controller. That is nothing but a BTS. So see here, to manage radio resources for BTS and assigns frequency and so as I already told you, so the responsibility of base station controller is to manage the BTS. So this is a BTS that is present in AP. So if you are traveling from one station to another station or from one place to another place, the signal should also get transmitted from one BTS to another BTS. So the transfer of this signal is taken care by the base station controller. Okay, and it also going to do the call setup. Whenever you make a call, its call setup, call connection is taken care by BSC. So handover means transferring the signals from one BTS to another BTS is called a handover. So these are the responsibilities of base station controller. So the very next concept is network switching networking subsystem. So the main heart of GSM is network subsystem. So it is going to contain with three components. One is mobile switching center, home location register and visitor location register. So first, coming to MSC, mobile switching center, the main component of this network switching subsystem is mobile switching center. So what happens when this mobile switching center is, in order to make a call, till now in the RSS we dealt with handover of signal takes place by BSC, but in order to connect a call, okay, that is taken care by MSC. So I assume that your phone is here and another phone is here, and this is from AP and this is from Kerala, and this is taken care by MSC and this is taken care by MSC. So what happens, this is transferred to, first the call is transferred to BTS and then to BSC and then to MSC, and from this MSC it is transferred to MSC of Kerala, okay, and then to BSS and then to BSC and then to BTS and then to mobile station. Okay, so whenever you are making a call, first it needs to identify in which part of the area it is. So that is BSS. Okay, so after that it is sent, that signal will be sent to BSC and to that respective BTS and then to the mobile station. Okay, so this entire process is taken care by the MSC, and this is the heart of NSS. With respect to this, it is also going to provide you some with supplementary service. So what are the supplementary services? Call waiting and call holding, as we have already dealt with. So these are some of the supplementary services that are present in MSC. Okay, and next coming to HLR. So HLR is a permanent database. So what happens in this permanent database is so wherever the SIM gets registered, it is going to be maintained in HLR, where this HLR contains mobile number, location area update, and next year IMEI numbers and TMSI numbers and MSRN. So whenever you are in roaming, it will be taken care by MSRN. And next thing is, whenever you move to the other areas or some other different states, it is alerted with some temporary number called temporary mobile subscriber identity. And whenever you this location area will be updated as Tenali. So that is the concept of HLR. And next, coming to VLR. So what does VLR contains? Whenever you are moving to new places, all the details that are present in HLR will be transferred to the VLR by using some authentication. So in order to verify whether you are a valid user or not, so the details will be taken from HLR to VLR. So that is VLR. And next thing is operating subsystem. So as I already told you, the operating subsystem is going to provide you with three components. One is OMC, authentication center, equipment identity register, and OMC. So first is OMC. So what is this OMC? Whenever you make a call, you'll be getting updates, or you'll be getting pop-ups related to billing. So by the end of the month, you need to recharge your plan account. If it is expired, you will get expired update. If you make a call, you will get the data balance and everything. So that is functionality of operation and maintenance center. And next thing is authentication center. So whenever you are speaking in the network, your signals get transmitted into the network. So in order to make the signals transferred in a secure way, you are using this authentication center. So what happens is, whatever you speak, they will be encrypted using A5 and A8 algorithms. So by using this encryption, it is going to digitalize that signals and get encrypted, and it makes the signal to get transferred to the receiver. Okay. And next thing, equipment identity register. So the name itself indicates equipment. So what is the equipment here? Our mobile phone. So in this, it is going to contain three lists. One is whitelist, second one is blacklist, and third one is gray list. So what does whitelist contain? It contains valid IMEIs. That means whatever the mobile phones we are used for talking, those are present in valid IMEI. And blacklist contains that are blocked. So why it's blocked means, whenever you lost your SIM, what happens? Immediately the service provider will block that number for 6 months, and that number will not be allotted for other users. And gray list, it is going to contain the numbers that are with threatening calls. So that type of IMEIs are present in gray list. So this is the overall architecture of GSM. Thank you.